series. There's certainly great expectations for today, and we also have Massimiliano Corsini with us, and I'll leave the floor to Massimiliano so that he'll introduce Professor Quattrociocchi. Thank you, both of you. The floor is yours.
Good morning to all. Today, this lecture is about social network, social media, and fake news, and how these fake news or other information propagates on the social network, etc., etc. But Professor Quattrociocchi is a worldwide leading expert in these, and some of these studies have been mentioned by the New York Times, the Washington Post, etc. And now he is a professor at l'Università La Sapienza of Rome. And the title of the talk is From Confirmation Bias to Echo Chambers. So please, Professor Quattrociocchi.
Thank you.
I have finished. Okay.
So if you want, I can start directly. So, okay, I will do by full screen, so it's gonna be easier, hopefully. Okay, can you see it clearly, everyone? Can you hear me and see? Okay, super. So let's start by, this presentation is gonna be a brief walk in our research history. But before starting, on the story, I would have to introduce some data points, some concepts. First of all, our approach is based on the idea of complex system. So we do data-driven modeling of complex system. It's a buzzword to say that we pick data, we try to model data as a complex network, and we try to extract the dominant feature of the system in order to understand its inner dynamics, with the idea having in mind the aim of predicting what is going on. And in particular, this story is about fake news. No? You know, you heard about social media that are taking over the world. Social media are destroying Western democracies. We are invaded by fake news. So it's a mess, especially when Trump won the election in 2016. It was a really a major problem. Now that Biden won, is a little bit different. I mean, social media are not so bad. I mean, so fake news depends, the threat of fake news depends on who is leading the world at this moment. So maybe there is something strange behind this frame of mind of the story. In fact, I mean, my point is to destroy the concept, the formalization of fake news like it is stated until now. I mean, the problem of fake news as it is presented in the mainstream media, is kind of bogus, is kind of nonsense. I mean, they are proposing a world in which there are good people, bad people say fake news, good people say the truth. And actually we know as academics that the universe is pretty much more complicated than this. And this is, for instance, an example of fake news, in a sense that we can have fake news, and it depends on the context in which we want to spread an information. Those are fake zebra, for instance. I mean, zebra that are trying to appear like news, and that's still an artifact, is a creation, is an artifact by trying to provide something ironic that is actually the major aim of social media. In fact, on social media, social media are not designed to provide correct information. Social media are made for entertainment. So we spend our spare time by looking at the contents of our friends, and the most of the time, those are jokes or something that nothing has to do with the diffusion of truth. Just for example, the image with more likes on Instagram is just an egg, not a theorem from Einstein or something different. I mean, social media are made for entertainment. I shared this. This is for sure false, okay? But this is ironic. So what does it mean, fake news spreading on a system that is made for entertainment. It's kind of strange, no? For instance, this is an old advertisement from the 40s, in which the spot is proposing the radioactive water. And if a brand nowadays apply this kind of campaign, maybe it may sound weird, at least could be strange to have the radioactive water. However, still, this on the contest of the 40 was acceptable because, you know, a lot of heroes get their power after getting in contact with something radioactive. So that's a main treat. Oh, this is the hypnotic pillow that could be considered a kind of fake news, but it was true in that time. I mean, at least trustworthy in that period of time in the 40s. Now, I mean, you can think that a lot of things that we that we think are good stuff and real stuff, maybe in the next 20, 30 years could be kind of wrong. So maybe there will be someone presenting, showing how much we were stupid in believing such a kind of stuff. The problem of fake news, actually, after the election of Trump, there is a strong correlation between the importance of fake news and the election of Trump in 2016, was taken by from the Oxford Dictionary. The Oxford Dictionaries pick elected like word of the year post-truth. Post-truth means basically that we are more influenced by emotion that rather than from facts. And that's kind of strange, no? Actually, it's kind of discovering that the human being is kind of irrational in 2016. So something changed in 2016. Social media make the human being totally irrational according to the mainstream narrative. And this is kind of bogus. And so in this context, our idea was let's collect data since we have tons of data in this environment. Tons of data, for instance, consider that on Facebook, a kind of 3 million of posts every minute. 3 million of posts every minute. So there is a huge amount of information spreading through the internet. And our question was, can we use this data to understand what is really driving the information diffusion online? Is really a matter of fake news versus real news? Or it is something a little bit more complicated, okay? And so, following the idea of David Lazar that he proposed in 2009, let's join forces between hard science and sociology and politology. Let's start to drive something and craft research question starting from data that we can analyze. I was a kind of roommate of David Lazar for a couple of years when I was in Boston. So I was at the beginning really starting to enjoy this criterion of creating the stuff. And this idea is particularly focused and catchy for the scientific community because there is the so-called crisis of the soft science. So experiment coming from behavioral economics or from social psychology proved to lack in the reproducibility of experiments. So at least half of the experiment coming from that field cannot be reproduced with the same setting. So this means that there is a lack in the reliability of the results from this scientific field. And so we start to model data, tons of data. So for instance, on the top left corner, we have the distribution of languages by looking at Twitter and how people tweet. And so we built a map of the languages on the state of New Jersey just by looking at Twitter. Or in the bottom right corner, we have the distribution of the Occupy movement as it was seen from Facebook. So people joining on Facebook and how they scattered all over the world and they interacted together. But still, this is a problem. This is, this is not science. This is not science. This is just descriptive statistics. A really nice plot, a really nice picture. But if I will try to do the same plot for the state of New Jersey today, it's going to be totally different. If I'm going to do the same plot for the Occupy movement, it's going to be totally different. This is just a picture of something happening, while our approach is to design the dynamics in order to predict the structure of the system. And so to do this, we paid a lot of effort in trying to draft a nice research question on an interdisciplinary perspective. And this was really difficult because talking with people from communication science or from sociology is not easy for people from quantitative hard science. And maybe vice versa, it's really difficult to talk with us in order to understand what we can draw out. And so actually we started by grabbing from the communication science the theory of the agenda setting. It's a really old theory that is just stating that the more a news is covered by the media, the more this is perceived to be important for the audience. And then there is a kind of hypothesis on a shift of paradigm in which we were on the old media platforms, so just journals and newspapers and TV news, in which there was a group of people, the journalists, selecting the information to report on to the audience. Nowadays, the situation is kind of hybrid. It's strange in a sense that there is still this group of people selecting information, but there is a large amount of competition for the attention of the users. And the most of the time, the topic, the agenda is driven by the number of likes. So the more a news is compelling, captivating, the more it is perceived to be important to an extent that these dynamics can influence the way journalists and experts select information to report on to the audience. And this creates a kind of strange situation. To make it clear, internet was designed to make safer the distribution of the information for the army. So it started by a really centralized approach, and the strategy was to distribute this information in order to be more resilient to eventual attack. And actually, internet is designed to distribute the information, to create a kind of, to break the hierarchy of the structure of information. And actually, it is breaking this system pretty well, even in the terms of the business model of the information production. To an extent that in 2007, so really far away from the idea of fake news and so on, Mark Z said, we don't want to create and to build a new community. We just want to provide users tools to share and communicate information. This is exactly saying we want to destroy hierarchies in information spreading and in the business model. People have the power to share, promote, and diffuse the information, at least. That's in theory. Then it's really much complicated than this. The problem, indeed, is the quality of information. We have a lot of information, but since we have a lot of producers of information, this quality of information may be a little bit strange, weird, at least. Just to give you an example of what is really behind fake news diffusion and misinformation diffusion. That's an anecdotal example that explains pretty well this intermediate environment. In May, to the journalist, their plan to do a kind of military exercise on Texas, military exercise. It started the live tweet from journalists talking about this event, and it started to be kind of strange. The transformation, the spreading of the message start to change the original message until it became something like, hey, look, Obama want to take over Texas with the army. Who believe in that? Who trust in this kind of information? Everyone, almost everyone. Even the governor of Texas, Greg Abbott, alerted the National Guard to control borders in under the idea that Obama was to start a kind of civil war. That's the dynamics of information in a disintermediated environment. Lot of information, lot of unreliable transformation in disinformation. In Italy, we have pretty much the same, but we exploited this phenomenon to do a lot of jokes. We collected tons of mocking, trolling stuff in order to measure how people were likely to end up in sharing fake news. So we created fake news in order to see who are the people that were more prone to share this kind of information. And so we started by Pertini, that in the Italian context is kind of a symbol of honesty and on the political good welfare. The idea was that we coupled this symbol with a kind of quotes that is kind of inviting to revolt. That is actually, it reads, when the government doesn't do what the people want, people are allowed to revolt. That is actually pretty strange. The information has been debunked several times from the Foundation Pertini. So this is a fake. We know this is a fake because it is a joke. And actually, with this information, we did 3.5 million sharing. And actually, this is in Italian, so I will translate later, but actually this is Michele Santoro, a journalist, that asked to the boss of a protest, the Forconi movement, why they put this picture of Pertini on the flyer to invite people to manifest against the government, and actually the answer give exactly what is behind fake news.
Protesta, diciamo, le manifestazioni che si stanno svolgendo, ma la convocazione era cacceremo questo governo con le mazze e con le pietre, anche con le mazze e con le pietre. Cioè, questo è scritto nel volantino di convocazione, non è che un'invenzione della stampa, l'avete scritto voi.
Non so se l'ha detta Pertini quella frase, non lo so, perché qualcuno dice che l'abbia detta Pertini, ora non ho scavato molto, però è una frase che ci piace. Voglio chiedere...
Clear? I don't know if Pertini say that, but I like it. So why you put this image on the flyer to invite people on the protest? And the answer is actually really innocent. He's saying, I don't know if Pertini say that. I don't know if it is true. I don't care if this is true. I like it. So this is confirmation bias, accepting information, using information that support one's point of view. And ignore dissenting information. And now we were pretty much like prone to say, oh yes, it's full of stupid people trying to follow in this kind of joke and mocks. I will never do like this. I'm not the kind of man or girl or woman that is able to find good stuff in this kind of jokes. And actually I can show you exactly that everyone in the right condition can be a victim of fake news or troll stuff. For instance, this is an interview of mine, okay? So the Wired, an important journal about scientific and technological development, give an interview of mine about the behavior of conspiracy theorists, people that believe in conspiracy theories, because we just proved that there were no difference between people that follow scientific information and people that follow conspiracy information in terms of spreading pattern. What we found is exactly this behavior that is pretty much similar. What it changed, it is just the kind of information they follow. The behavior is exactly the same. And so this is an interview of mine. My name is reported on the article several times. So Walter Quattrociocchi. But actually, I mean, I did a joke. Another joke in this context. I commented by playing the role of the conspiracy guy. In a sense, I wrote, oh, why you are you think that you are better than us just because we don't follow mainstream information. Okay, just this comment, these two lines of comment, 3 minutes later, caused the arrival of the social blasting leader, someone that came to me by telling me, oh, you not even read the paper. Notice that the name of the commenters is the one that is reported on the interview. He is the one that actually was the one not reading the paper at all. So everyone put in the right condition, in the right settlement, is able to be credulous, because we want to believe what we want to believe. They were looking for a conspiracy guy. Doesn't matter if the conspiracy guy appearing like a conspiracy guy is the author of the study reported on the media. The important is to blast someone just because I want to feel stronger by imposing my view on the others. And because every one of us is susceptible to biases, everyone was. If you look to these two pictures in the center, you will see different pictures. I mean, you know that you will try to see that both circles in the center are exactly the same, but your perception actually is freezing, in a sense that for sure every one of you is seeing the one on the right bigger than the one on the left. Despite this, those are similar. Our perception, the way we process information, is biased. How many legs has this elephant? And you see that our brain start to feel a little bit uncomfortable by facing this question, because it's really difficult to cut the line. How many triangles here we have? Actually, no one. But we will see triangle. We tend to complete images when we have this kind of stuff. So this just to show that when we process information, we apply biases. Thinking that biases are just a problem of other people is a bias itself. We are all together having the same brain structure, more or less. And on the social media, this situation can be kind of exploited in augmenting the kind of interaction we can do. For instance, those are not legs, are not whistle, are just fingers that are playing a picture behind the computer. We can create artifacts. And we exploited this amount of information to study misinformation diffusion through trolling. We trolled people to study the diffusion of conspiracy theories. Actually, the idea was that the question framing was built on the field of sociology, communication, psychology, semiotics, and anthropology. Then we collected a lot of data and worked on data collection and transformation. So we played surveys, we ran algorithms, we performed data transformation and analytics. Then we performed the quantitative analysis by using network science, machine learning, and statistical mechanics. And we model the quantitative analysis on a question-based model that try to explain, like the spreading of a virus, how information diffuse over social media. And as far as you know, this is the famous experiment, Hash experiment, the Hash dilemma. The Hash dilemma is an experiment that basically put 10 people within a room and ask only one is the real subject. The others are just actors that have to provide suggest the wrong answer in order to bias the answer of the subject. And the question is really simple. We have three bars having different length. And the question is, which one of the three bars is long as exhibit one? And actually the answer is simple. It's just A, okay? Is simple and clear. The experiment is made to measure how much we are susceptible to deception. And actually, out of 18 trials, 12 prove positive for deception. We are pretty much susceptible to the suggestion of the other, even if we know that the suggestion is false. And so this creates a kind of complication. I mean, you know, physicists would love to model information diffusion like a virus, but actually it seems to be pretty much more complicated than this. Ideas and behavior follow really different dynamics that involve intentionality. I mean, a virus just arrive, I mean, by contact. The information, even if I get exposed to the information, I will adopt the information just if I like the information. Otherwise, I will refuse that kind of contagion. So there is an intentionality, there is a role of trust. So I have to trust the source of the information in order to adopt the information. There is also a lot of attitudes that shape the frame of mind of the adopter. Then there are a lot of social norms. So people playing a role, a lot of contagion from other people on the mind frame of the users that is going to adopt the information. And last but not least, I mean, depends on how do you prefer this, is the confirmation bias. The tendency to acquire information that adhere to our system of belief and to ignore dissenting information. Okay, that's confirmation bias. And actually, our experiment was pretty simple. I mean, we pick up all the Facebook page in Italy and US. We divided these pages in two main sets. One is about science communication, so all pages, sources reporting on scientific information. And on the other side, all the information reporting on conspiracy theories. We collected data about 3 million of people for the Italian case and 55 million of people for the US case. The experiment actually was really simple, was how people usually exposed to conspiracy theory respond to two kinds of stimuli. The first is information adhering to their system of belief and containing false claims, the trolls joke we made before, I showed you before, and now they respond to information dissenting their narrative. So if you believe in chemtrails or in aliens, how do you react to a post or an article telling that aliens do not exist? Debunking information. So we have all the measure to state the role of confirmation bias in information diffusion on social media. And actually the result of experiment is pretty simple. Is people that follow conspiracy theory, just follow conspiracy theory. People that follow scientific information, just follow scientific information, plus they tend to cluster all together. People having interest in conspiracy theory tend to be friends of people having the same interest. We tend to create kind of homophilic cluster. We create group of like-minded people sharing the same narrative, sharing the same narrative. And this is the concept behind the idea of echo chambers. Echo chambers that are this group of like-minded people collaborating on social media to frame and share a shared narrative. How conspiracy theorists respond to troll information mocking their narrative? Actually, they act with this information at the same way with like other information. There is no difference, actually. They interact with this information like if they belong to their usual information basin. And actually, while this is how they respond to debunking and dissenting information, and actually this is a really sad result. They ignore correction, they ignore dissenting information. There is just a small fraction of conspiracy theorists interacting with information from the banking site, fact-checking information services. And those ones are first the most active one. So people that are really engaged with the conspiracy theory. Second, once they get exposed to conspiracy theory, after they get exposed to conspiracy theory, they improve the amount of interaction with conspiracy information. This is called backfire effect. If you want to prove someone that is wrong, his reaction is going to look for kind of information supporting his narrative. So he's going to be more active in consuming conspiracy theory. So actually, according to this information, debunking is not a good option when you are facing negationist, when you are facing no mask, when you are facing people that really strongly believe in their narrative. Is not the good tool to fight polarization and conspiracy theories. Having these models, having this frame of mind, these data points, this insight, we were able to provide an important paper on the disinformation diffusion online. We model the diffusion of information online, and actually we notice that information spread just within the echo chamber. There is a huge probability, high probability, that you will share a content from someone that is pretty much like-minded with you. And the more we are embodied in this echo chamber structure, the more we tend to be negative, to assume extremism in the way we talk online. So if we talk together with like-minded people, our attitude in expressing our comment will tend toward to be more negative than before. The longer we stay in the echo chamber, the more negative is going to be the commenting of the users. And the situation is pretty much worse if two people from two different echo chamber meet. People from the conspiracy side, if they meet extremist people from the scientific side, then we start to fight together like a war. So this is even worse. There is no way to communicate on social media. And there was a kind of, another point to extend this analysis, since it was built on a selected case of science and conspiracy information, we want to prove to study if this kind of dynamics hold even on the consumption of information on social media. And so we perform an analysis of a huge amount of people, almost 300 millions of people on a time span of 6 years, and we measure how people consume information from news outlet passing through Facebook. How is their behavior when relating to posts from news outlets like the Washington Post, the New York Times, Republica, and so forth. And actually what we found is exactly the dynamics as expected. The more we are active, the less the number of pages we follow. In a sense that we tend to get stuck in a kind of system of reinforcement in which we get affectionated to a specific source, we remain over there and collect friendship, virtual friendship, with people doing the same stuff. So if I'm an actor on Republica, I will have a lot of friends being exposed to the Republica content. So the selective exposure, this tendency to select the information that we love and to ignore the information we don't like, dominate even news consumption online. And this old for the Brexit. We find the same dynamics on the Brexit case. So strong polarization, people that are following sources pro-Brexit are just following that kind of sources, and isolate from people that are for the Remain. But there is no one that is in the middle. We all tend to be on or one side or the other. We tend to be in our bubble, in our echo chamber in any case, even if we do not believe that we are living in an echo chamber. We apply the same dynamics for the vaccine case, and we find exactly the same polarization. Pro-vax with pro-vax, anti-vax with anti-vax, and there is no superposition of the parties. And so we implemented a model. I wrote a blog on the World Economic Forum agenda by proposing this kind of approach that we have to look to monitor to polarization if we want to anticipate misinformation cascades. Because the more the polarization, the more the propaganda, the more the compelling of fake news. And actually, this is one final result. This is a paper that we are hopefully having published this month, hopefully, where we did a strong analysis, a massive data analysis on the effect of algorithms in bursting this polarization effect. The question is, how the different social media platforms like Reddit, Twitter, Facebook, or Gab, that is the social media of the American far right, burst polarization dynamics. And actually we found that Facebook and Twitter having feed algorithm, so algorithms that are informed by our behavior to propose content, specific content to us, burst this process of selective exposure and segregation to an extent that here on the right, we have the comparison of news on Facebook and Reddit, and on the first, we find a strong polarization, while on the second, there is no polarization. So there is even a matter of algorithm. This is the group that almost all the group, someone is missing, that was performing this analysis. There is from the left, Lucia Smith, that is a postdoc, now is working in as a data scientist in an important corporation that I cannot say the name. Then there is a mathematician that is Emanuele Brugnoli. Then there is Antonio Peruzzi, that is an economist, Antonio Scala, a physicist. Then there is Fabiana Zollo, that is a computer scientist he did the PhD with me 4 years ago now. I'm becoming old, come on. And then there is Matteo Cinelli, that is a postdoc, he's an engineer, and then there is a physicist, that is Carlo Valenzise, that is actually working to me as a postdoc here in Rome, is the first one of the new clan. Our result get covered by a lot of media coverage. We made close one of the debunking column of the Washington Post when we presented the result that debunking is ineffective in fighting hoax diffusion. We get translated, we have two numbers of Le Scienze, one main paper in Scientific American and blah, blah. And since 2016, the Global Risk Report of the World Economic Forum is using our models to talk about misinformation diffusion. Now we started another collaboration with the Ministry of Innovation and the AGCOM, the Data Force on Information during the COVID pandemics, and we are joining the Data for Good program of Facebook in order to stress the impact of communication on mobility and the application of the mobility restriction in Italy. So if you want to join us, you are pretty then welcome to work together. So, and that's all, I'm almost done. If there are questions, I'm pretty happy to answer.
Okay, very nice talk and very clear, and I will give the I think that Annalisa Sezzi or Sanna read the questions of the people, and the attendee can write in the chat the questions, and okay. And we ask it to Professor Quattrociocchi. Please.
There are no questions at the moment.
There are no questions?
Yes.
The concept of agenda setting.
Yeah.
The more you are active online, the more a news is repeated on the media, the more it is perceived to be important from the users. So if we talk about election in US, we will think, since we have a lot of exposition to this kind of information, we will think we will perceive this information as important. That's the agenda setting theory.
Okay.
Okay.
I do have a question.
Yeah, I have a question too, yeah.
Can you please detail a little bit more the paper that you said that is about to be published about polarization on different platforms? So how you get the data, what set up the experiment, what you consider as variable, etc.
Okay, I mean, they actually we pick up, we scrape data. So we pick up data through data scraping. So we provided specific tools to simulate users browsing online, and we collected all the data from Gab, Reddit, Twitter, and Facebook. And actually we compared the platform on topics, polarizing topics like gun control, abortion, and so on. And what we want to measure was, actually we define echo chamber like consumption of the same news on a specific source. Okay, for each source of information, we get the kind of political bias, political leaning, by looking at the data from mediabiasfactcheck.org that provide for each news outlet, for each source, for each link, if it belongs to the left, far left, far right, and so on. And so actually we are able to locate the interaction of the users with respect to the source. And then on the y-axis, we provided the number of people the users interact with, the leaning of the user, of the neighboring users, to identify echo chamber. And actually what we found that people from the left locate with people of the left and people from right locate with people from the right. And the more the correlation on Facebook and Twitter for polarization tend to one. While if you go on less controlled social media, like Reddit, the situation is pretty much different. In that context, the landscape of the distribution of the scattering of the users is pretty much spread and wide, less polarized. Is that enough?
Perfect.
Okay, I think there's one question from Tai.
Yeah. Thank you very much. I actually enjoyed the presentation. There's a lot that has been happening regarding this post-truth thing, and I think it was one of Trump's aides who used the term alternative fact, you know, to say, well, even if that was true, I mean, there's another truth somewhere. And the question that I actually want to ask is, how does the trend get countered? I mean, who does the countering of the trend, and how does it get countered? Because we've always known that media, I mean, rhetoric is about appeal to emotions and all that. But when actual lies are presented as truth, that's when the problem really arises. And it can
actually, I mean, the American election is a pretty wide contest. We didn't touch that yet. And we are doing a collection of data during the American election on this kind of stuff. But actually, as a scientist, I cannot set what is true and what is not. I have to observe the phenomenon on this side. And we can rely on the accuracy and the evaluation from third party issue. So we will trust, for instance, mediabiasfactcheck.org that provide evidence of what is reliable and what it is not reliable. I prefer to talk about not reliable and reliable information more than real and fake news. When you spread a lie, actually, it really depends on the kind of situation, because this is a kind of propaganda-like language, no? So the use of lies, the use of fictitious information to engage your party, your people, is actually the main determinant of the social dynamics. But actually, this happened on both sides. I mean, I wouldn't say that Biden didn't use propaganda. I mean, even if I can say that I'm happy that Trump has not been elected, okay? Just let me tell you this. I mean, I don't want to pass like the one that is supporting Trump. I'm just saying that on the propaganda, when there is the political language ongoing, both parties tend to use propaganda-like stuff. We did an experiment in Italy during the Renzi referendum, and actually we found that fake news were used pretty much from both parties, from both the one supporting the referendum and the oppositors. So when there is propaganda, there is a strong polarization, there is a huge propagation of fake news.
Yeah, what about when it goes, when it enters into scientific discourse?
When this enters in the scientific discourse, that's a problem. I mean, if you want, I can provide you a couple of examples right now, for instance. I mean, just for instance, if you want to talk about vaccine, no? Vaccine, the idea that vaccine can make you autistic, I mean, the autistic publication of this kind of stuff. Or the other lie, the lie that fake news spread faster than real news. That's a bullshit, that's a bogus. There is no proof. It's a paper on science saying that. However, I mean, sometimes, I mean, we have to cope even with that. I mean, what have to drive us is, you know, calm and skepticism. I mean, that's the, I think that the best approach to contrast this kind of information.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Okay, there are two questions in the chat. The first one, could you please repeat the concept of agenda setting?
Yeah, already stated. I already answered to this question.
Yeah, as you said, thank you. And then in Nigeria, the government is looking to brand all news. They cause government embarrassment is fake news. How do you think citizen journalism fuel fake news? To counter fake news, who should be tasked with the responsibility, bearing in mind that even the government peddles fake news? Okay. Complex question.
One, everyone may peddle fake news, okay? So in order to contrast this kind of issue, we cannot avoid the echo chamber approach. We will be sharing information with the people that are our friends, and we will have oppositors in this kind of stuff. In this issue, what does it mean is trust and reliability. So when it's missing trust in the official institution, it's really difficult to draw out a clean information environment. So I think that this context, I mean, is gonna happen almost everywhere in the idea that I'm really afraid of this idea of tagging everything like a fake news. Because, I mean, when you exploited this idea that you can brand a specific party, a specific ideology that is far from the mainstream as a fake news, to just to blame them, actually, is okay when you are on the mainstream side. But in the case you are going to be in the minority side, this is going to play against you. So for this reason, I was not so happy in seeing the journalist ignoring what Trump was saying during the election. Repeat, I'm not a supporter of Trump. I would say that a journalist should listen to the president and then comment and to provide evidence about his falsehood and fallacy in the speech, not censoring. Because when you enter in the censoring side, that is start to be something that is more dangerous than Trump itself.
Okay, other questions? Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I have a question, a curiosity about one of your last slides. Mm-hmm. When you said something about the fact that the recommendation algorithm matter in the polarization.
Sure. Yeah.
This is a very interesting point, because because so often social network platforms say that they don't have responsibility to the opinions of the people, but it's not, this means that it's not true. So at the end, so perhaps this is a very interesting point to
yeah they are informed about the finding. The answer of Facebook, they said, oh cool, it means that we have a really good targeting algorithm.
Yes. Okay, it's true.
no, actually the same to me, in a sense that they don't want to pass, like, they don't want to have the editorial responsibility of the content. They don't want this kind of stuff. Then having an evidence that the algorithm may burst the polarization dynamics, and so fake news is something important that is entering in the public discourse about this issue, public debate about this issue. Of course, we actually, our plan now is to start another project to study what are the parameters, so the setting of the algorithm that smooth this polarization dynamics. We are working in this direction and this issue, but still it's really difficult, really difficult.
Really difficult, yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome.
So there is another question about yes. Facebook and Twitter, if the fact checking can help in fighting the spreading of fake news.
I think that you can have the answer right now. No, there is no way, in a sense that fake news are still there because fact-checking doesn't work. In a sense, fact-checking is useful for the people that are already prone to acquire that kind of information. People that are dissenting this kind of information will just simply ignore the fact-checking articles. That's the dynamics. To an extent that no-vax, anti-vax are still there since and are increasing their number. There is a paper on Science, on Nature, from May, if I remember well, that actually proved that if we will continue like this, we will double the number of no-vax in a couple of years. What I think about the social dilemma. I can be honest or I have to be polite. It's full of bullshit, actually. It's really full of bullshit, in a sense that is made by people, is made by conspiracy guys that talk about how conspiracy guys think. Actually, there is a lot of false information and not scientific information in that documentary. It's nice because it put the focus on an important side, but actually the way they, okay, perfect. Actually, I don't care about helping Facebook and Twitter. I care about understanding the human dynamics through Facebook and Twitter data. So we are trying to build a synergy with them because they are interested in helping people in having a nice experience. So even avoiding polarization is part of this issue. But we want to understand the human behavior. I don't want to save the world. I don't care about saving the world. I want to understand the human behavior from a social dynamics. That's my job.
Okay. There are other questions. Three more questions. One is, have you seen the documentary, The Social Dilemma? What do you think about it? Then a second one is, in what way can your research help Facebook, Twitter to fight fake news? These are the first two, and then I let the third for, later, okay?
And then the other question is, other than start a war on comments, is it possible to use fake news with a positive purpose? Of course, that's a key point. Good question, Maria. Actually, it's a really good point. We can exploit fake news in order to make fun of hate speech. So making, playing with extremism by providing fake information, mocking extremism is a good approach to smooth this kind of tension we get when we are discussing online. So taking joke of people online is a good job. Yes, we can exploit fake news to smooth polarization. We have to have more fun online. Laughing is a good remedy against hate speech.
Another question from Jessica. She wants to ask, at the start you mentioned the correlation between jokes, again, and fake news. Could you tell us something more about it, please? You just mentioned. How is the language of joke used within echo chambers?
Actually, jokes are one of the main ingredients to gather people in an echo chamber, because the first entry level in an echo chamber, in a narrative, is the jokes, funny jokes about stuff. Jokes, in the most of the time, are fake news, according to the definition, main definition of fake news, are information containing false claims. The problem is that these jokes doesn't fit the definition of fake news in a sense that they are not intentionally devoted to manipulate the environment. However, they contain deliberately false claims. So, as you can see, my point that I was stressing at the beginning of the presentation is that the definition of fake news, like it is stated by dividing the word in fake and real news, is full of biases, is badly flawed, the definition of the problem of fake news, because we just consider as a counter example, funny jokes, those are fake news, but not belonging to their definition.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Jessica says thank you. Okay.
I would also like to ask a question, if it's still possible.
Of course.
Yeah.
Thank you. Sorry if I do not activate my video, but I think my laptop is dying on me. So pardon me. I would like to ask a question to Professor Quattrogiocchi. I actually had my master thesis on polarization in US cable news. So I am a little bit familiar with that topic. So what I wanted to ask is, where should we look for the causes that bring people, especially certain demographics, to believe this kind of fake news? Not so much those false information, because I believe everybody is capable to see whether something is true or not, and if they are giving a complete a false version of reality instead of a correct one. But there is an entire gray area of half truths, or not giving the complete version of something, and this is something that happens also with so many online magazines and with many of the Italian ones. I'm thinking La Repubblica, Il Messaggero, within their Facebook pages, they do this all the time. And while we are all capable of seeing that sometimes they're lying, many of us just want to believe that because it coincides with their version of reality. So we are kind of looking for, as you mentioned, a confirmation of what we already believe in, and we don't want to change our minds. So in your view, to sum up, what are the very deep causes that lead these people to be okay with this?
Distrust in official institution. Science is not communicating well and is perceived like something that is stealing money just for nothing. People are suffering, there is anxiety, there is the globalization that is creating problems to people, and people want a shortcut to identify an enemy to which attribute, so it's a kind of negation, no? You know, in psychology, we can have two kind of reactions in front of a trauma. The first one is negation, and the second one is remotion. In this context, remotion is the one that is working in this context. People that are So what is the identikit of the people believing in this kind of stories? All the people that are distrusting official institution and paying economical crisis and now the epidemiological crisis.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. So you would agree that to solve this problem, although it's very complex to
oh, of course. Yeah.
We will have
a solution actually. So,
yeah. Yeah, exactly. Solution. I mean, many proposals that we have seen, like calling out social media when they have algorithms that do not work in that sense, won't be enough. We need to have a real deep changes in our society and get rid of so very deep insecurity and collective anxieties in that sense.
Oh, yeah, really brilliant. I mean, actually, I love you that you give me the possibility to talk about that. I mean, we were asked several times what we can do to exit from this situation. Actually, I don't know. I don't know. I mean, what we can do is just understanding the real role of social media. Social media are made for entertainment, no? So we provided with some people from working in scientific communication, we designed a format for media literacy. It is not the one looking, oh, look, this is the good source, this is the bad source, look, this is a fake news, this is not a fake news. No, we went there just by providing awareness of our biases, awareness of the kind of frame of mind we play when we are online, make aware of people about the echo chamber, so the selective exposure that we get exposed to information that we like to see, both for the algorithm, both and for the kind of people that we used to see online, and to show how much is complicated to communicate a message without exploiting polarization. And actually, this approach works pretty well. And we planned to do this on a national scale in Italy last year, but then there was COVID and it was really difficult to start to expand the dissemination of the format.
There is another question from the chat. Ludmilla is asking clarification. At the beginning of your lecture, you mentioned someone who said that it was just giving people the tools to share, etc., etc. And
Mark Zuckerberg, I mean, the CEO of Facebook.
Other question?
I also wanted to ask a question if I can.
Yes.
Sorry.
Yes,
hi. No, I just have a small question. Like, is there a reason I've always found out that when there are fake news, it is easier for older people to believe in them, and while younger people tend to like check better. So is there a reason for, like, in my family, my parents, for example, believe in fake news more than I do, for example, or my sister does. So is there a reason for a generational gap? Is there a generational gap or like, sorry, thank you.
Technically speaking, we don't know. We have conflicting results. One is saying that you are right. Another one from Stanford last year is saying exactly the opposite, that people that from the younger people are not able to distinguish reality from fake news. So it's really complicated to understand. I think that, as usual, is a matter of cognitive understanding and background. So it really depends on the kind of situation in the mood. I don't think that there is a kind of generational gap. Is the ability for the experience that provide you the tools to understand that something can be just a joke, something fake, and people that are less exposed or less experienced to the system. But still, I mean, for instance, there is a quite strong result that is providing evidence that the more the level of education of people, the less the ability to change their mind. So once they follow in a gap, in a fake news, it's really difficult to change, to correct their kind of stuff. So even believing in the critical thinking and in the education actually is not the exact stuff. What we have to be aware of is that actually our way of processing information is always biased, and we have a cognitive limit, we have a bounded rationality, and we have to have a peaceful approach with our limits. Once we accept this, everything is going to be, I think, easier, hopefully.
Thank you.
Yeah, sorry, may I?
Please, Tai, go ahead. You just muted your microphone, Tai.
Oh, I see, sorry, right, sorry. Yeah, that question was interesting to me, and I had something in mind that maybe older people just don't care anymore, you know, about some of these things. I don't know. That's by the way. But as a follow-up, I wanted to ask, is there a gender gap then in terms of who believes and who does not believe fake news?
What do you mean? What do you mean by
a gender gap? I mean, would men, for example, believe fake news more than women? Or the other way around?
Actually, I don't know. Actually, really, I don't have data about that. It's really difficult to play this kind of role, but I don't think that is I think that is a matter of context. I mean, what really doesn't matter is that the more the distrust, the more fake news. I mean, we did a comparison in information consumption between Italy, France, Germany, and UK. And what we found actually is that in France and Spain, there is less fake news because the level of trust in official institutions is higher. While in Italy, France, UK, the situation is pretty much different. So actually, I think that one that is something that is pivotal is the distrust. And I don't think that is a gender-related aspect to this one.
I think it was Germany and Spain that believed in their governments, actually.
Sorry?
It was Germany and Spain who believed in their governments, and Italy and France and the UK did not.
Maybe, yeah, I think so. I mean, we correlated the two dimensions, no? The polarization and fake news with the trust from surveys from all countries. And actually what correlates is that actually the trust or distrust in the national governments. That's the main stuff.
Can I come back to the concept of frame? Because you had this Zuckerberg quote from 2007 where he said, we just provide the tools. But of course, in this context, you have to see the frame that for him, he wanted to give himself a good legal frame. If you only provide the tools, then you're innocent about all the content. And that has been a big EU debate for a long time. So maybe if we can generalize that, I still think that the concept of frame is very useful, in particular in teaching, where you have to say whatever the text is, you have to try to find out about the frame and the persons who in the end profit from it. Would you agree?
Of course. I mean, it was just a kind of ironic, he saying, we don't want to create a new community. We want just to provide tools for people to share information. And actually, this was actually the killer of the previous business model of information. I mean, I was just stressing this aspect, this funny aspect of his sentence, actually.
There is another question from the chat. Maria Bortoluzzi is asking if you can tell us more about the national program about raising awareness about these issues and about the group you started but was stopped by the COVID emergency.
Yeah, it was founded actually from Facebook. It was founded by Facebook. It is called Memedia, and actually is a format of lasting 4 hours. There is 2 sessions. The first one in which we present the biases, part of the slides I showed you, the one of the with the circle with the elephant and so on. So making people aware. The first question is, what do you think about fake news? And so you collect all the information, and they start to say fake news are bad, fake news are manipulating us, fake news, blah 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 blah. And then you start to show them, this is a fake news, yes, this is a fake news, no. And then you start with jokes, this is a fake news. And then, so the definition start to seems to be a little bit limited. And then, so we start to provide something more. The idea is, do you believe in chemtrails? No. Do you believe in homeopathic medicine? Oh, yes, most of them raise their hand. So you know that this is even a fake news. And so making all people aware that, first of all, that we are all stupid in under certain circumstances, no? Believing in fake news. And then after this, we started by providing two sessions, two kind of simulation. The first one is do memes just with the mobile phone. So they divide in group and start to do memes, memes together. And so then we discuss the memes together, and the memes just provide evidence of the echo chamber. So the memes is made for a specific group of people talking a specific language that is just understandable from a restricted set of people. And then we start to provide about hate speech. We provide some news from Google News, a polarizing news generally, argument about science, about COVID pandemics and so on. And they have to simulate to be the social media manager of an institution or an influencer. And they have to plan a communication campaign in order to smooth polarization. And they, the most of the time in this kind of step, get depressed because it's really difficult to smooth down the polarization. And then in the really end, I give a short talk of 20 minutes about talking about how science is working in this direction. And in the end, it works pretty well because it's funny, it's informed, and is easy. We provided it to people from the students from the high school, people from the college, people from the university. So I would say that from 12, from the teens to up is gonna be is a kind of good format. We would love to make it in all the Italian schools. That was the plan with Facebook. And we are just waiting that the COVID situation allows for this kind of program. But now I think that is pretty much far. No, I don't believe that. I mean, I never believe in, not even in the Cambridge Analytica scandal. I mean, because not because it is not true. I mean, people are trying to distort opinions, but the problem is that this doesn't work. I mean, what Cambridge Analytica did, at least they say that they did, I mean, it's still to prove, is that they provide ads to specific segment of the audience in order to change their mind. Now, just to provide you an example, if you see the advertisements, an ad about something that you don't care, you are gonna change your mind or not? No. If it is something related to something that you are already prone to do, you are not gonna change your mind. You are just changing your attitude. You are just moving. So actually, they are not able to change people's mind. They are maybe able to move someone to express his own opinion. But still, the Brexit election was not lost. The Brexit or the election of Trump was not for a couple of votes. It was something more than this. So I don't think that Cambridge Analytica and this kind of manipulation can change the electoral result. Just a bullshit from journalists and the editorial boards, because they are not the leader of the attention of the users on the news market. That's the main issue.
I have a question from the chat that is asking to intervene verbally. Ludmilla, please, you can activate your microphone if you wish.
Hello, do you listen to me?
Yes.
Okay, hello, Professor. I'm Ludmila from Brazil, actually. Thank you for your lecture. I've been thinking during all your lecture about the dynamics, if you had the interest or already had any works on the dynamics also of the chance, the phenomenon of chance, 4chan, 8chan, and how similar and how different they would be. from social networking?
Actually, we are studying this. I mean, we are really at the really beginning of the stuff. We are starting with this kind of issue, so I don't have any data point at the moment.
Oh, sweet. My master's has to do with 4chan, and it's difficult to find studies about the dynamics of 4chan, especially the poll, and how the poll intervenes and the dynamics of fake news and internet. So I would like to know about that if I could.
Just write me an email and I will keep you updated with the advances. I mean, maybe we can talk later about this. I mean, we can have a more specific task on this direction. I mean, we found a lot of limits in this stuff, really a lot of limits.
Okay, thank you very much.
To all, we are really open to collaborations. So if we want to join us with ideas, stuff, other issues, we will be pretty happy to work together.
Thank you very much.
We have another question from the chat. The use of terms fake news to discard the ideas we found not in line with our belief, is it shaping the society to have rather than a skeptical mind in a ego society where everything depends on your own opinions rather than facts?
Maria is really brilliant, I would say. She's really in the problem. She got exactly the perspective. Actually, it's the same. My fear right now. My fear. I mean, the extremization of this kind of stuff is becoming something just to dismiss the other opinion. And we are not talking to each other. Then we are losing the ability to communicate with the other. It's a wonderful speech of Samantha Power that she gave. Samantha Power is the ex-US ambassador to the United Nations, and she was doing a kind of keynote speech to the Yale graduation ceremony, and she was talking about the echo chambers. I mean, we worked with his husband, so maybe they exchanged some information in this kind of issue. And actually, she said something that is really enlightening. She said, "We don't have to talk with people just to shutting them up or to change their view, but we have to talk with people because they must just be right." So restoring the communication perspective. And actually, the situation like at the moment is really going toward polarization, even looking on the way journalists are playing about the actual US elections. He's not talking, this is just an ego. He's an ego society. And that's all.
Any more questions from the chat? We still have 5 minutes. I may have another comment on the polarization part. Okay. Waiting for the questions. It's more like a It's not really a question, it's more like a debate stuff. You said that you scraped some data simulating some browsing behaviors in your last work. And my question is, maybe starting with the browsing behavior and then studying the algorithmic personalization is not part of the echo chambers. I mean, it has to do with the echo chambers on social media, of course. But echo chambers are an active process, meaning that we can measure echo chambers with interaction, sharing, comments, and so on. While the filter bubble, the algorithmic personalization is a passive process because I get content selected for me based on my browsing behavior, and I don't know why. This is the problem with social media today. So I think that this is the topic of my thesis, reading a lot of papers, these concepts are quite often used as synonym, and they are not very well distinguished. Do you think that it's useful to distinguish, to explore a little bit more the interaction that are between filter bubble and echo chamber, or it's just an academia stuff?
No. I mean, I don't care too much about academia debate. I mean, what you put on the table actually is a really important research question, because basically state on the interplay between algorithm and the user behavior, how much the algorithm amplify the user behavior. And actually, this is a big question right now. I mean, it's the $10 million question. And actually, everyone is trying to answer to this kind of process. The problem is, that it's really difficult to design an experimental setting based on data in order to answer to this kind of answer from the backside, because we have to reverse engineering the algorithm. And actually, it's not simple, even because the algorithm change pretty often. The parameters of the algorithm change pretty often. We tried once to do that, and it was really difficult to set up to analyze the behavior. So, of course, I mean, I would love to answer to this question. I mean, I really would love to have this idea. However, I mean, I just saying that we collected, by scraping, tens of dozens of fake agents in order to scrape data and to collect the overall session. We avoided the echo chamber approach because we have a control on the kind of expansion tree that the page we were visiting. There's a kind of war against, I mean, it's a kind of cybersecurity war when you play with these agents to download data. Because, I mean, the agents of Facebook to check, to block your connection in scraping data are pretty good. Okay, that's...
Okay, there aren't any more questions. It's 4:30, so maybe I give now again the turn of Professor Elsa Marina Bondi to conclude the lecture.
Well, to conclude, but just thanking you very much. You see the discussion's been very active, and I'm sure there would be more questions coming, and there probably will be more questions coming. So thanks again very much, and thank you to the participants and with the other participants. Hope to see you next week for our next talk. Thanks very much. Thank you.
Thank you. See you.
Goodbye to all.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Hey.
Bye-bye, everyone.